I'm Luke Hart of the Middletown Health Department, and this is Healthline. Are you or someone you know one of the approximately 2 million Americans who suffer from heel pain each year? The heel is the largest bone in your foot, and sometimes it can produce a source of major discomfort. And although that discomfort is rarely a symptom of serious health condition, it can escalate to the point where normal activity can be extremely painful. Dr. Jeffrey Kahn is here to explain what causes heel pain, why it may get worse if ignored, and what other complications that can be related to your feet. Welcome to Healthline. Our guest today is Dr. Jeff Kahn. Dr. Kahn is a podiatrist specialist with Connecticut Foot Care Centers. Dr. Kahn, welcome back to the program.
That's a pleasure to be here, Lou.
We've had you on a few times, and we're going to talk a little bit about foot pain today, and especially heel pain. We're going to start off with that, but talk about some other conditions related to the foot. But before we even get into that, let's find out a little bit, again, if you remind the folks about what you do as a podiatrist.
Sure. A podiatrist is the medical practitioner that cares for pretty much anything and everything having to do with the foot and ankle. So essentially, it ranges anything from ankle sprains and injuries to some of the more advanced practitioners fixing ankle fractures, all the way down to simply diabetic foot care and trimming of corns and calluses and treating ulcers and infections.
Are you allied with other health professionals, such as a orthopedist, or is it something that's totally separate?
Well, it's a little bit of both. I mean, some of the diabetic care is usually in concert with your primary care docs, sometimes an endocrinologist. The more complicated issues may require plastic surgeons or vascular surgeons, very commonly. So it's a little bit of both. It's often a team effort.
Let's talk about heel pain and specifically today. To start off, tell us a little bit about why heel pain is so prevalent these days.
Well, first, it's kind of interesting to note that the number one diagnosis that people come to see a podiatrist for is actually heel pain. And I know that's striking to many people, but so many of us, including me, have suffered with heel pain. And heel pain essentially is the result of usually the foot structure breaking down, which is a common finding as we get older, and the arch structure will tend to drop. And the ligament on the bottom, which is called the plantar fascia, tends to stretch only to a certain point and then becomes inflamed. So you may have heard people talking about, especially in the running community and sports, oh, I have plantar fasciitis, and it's constantly painful. I can't run. I can't play. I can't actually work at times. So they're complicated issues, but they're all interrelated. So you can deal with plantar fasciitis. You can deal with a heel spur, which is, you know, very often where the plantar fascia begins on the heel, and bursitis is also very common. In addition to that, people that try just to put up with it, especially the heel pain, as you had mentioned, becoming more complicated, they tend to walk differently. They tend to favor their gait. They tend to roll their foot. As a result, they often will create an irritation to a nerve on the inside of the heel itself, which is extremely painful.
Is this pain that comes on early, is this something that happens every day and just gets worse, or can this come and go and then eventually get to the point where I've got to see a doctor?
Yeah, that's a fantastic question, because very often I will make your diagnosis partially on what you tell me. You tell me that you have pain first thing in the morning getting out of bed, you walk 10, 20 steps, you probably have bursitis and potentially a heel spur. If your pain is not in the morning, you get out of bed, you're doing your stuff, as you're going through the day, being more active, it's getting worse, it's probably a spur.
And the diagnosis, you would make that when somebody comes in to see you?
Correct.
You would talk to them about it. Would something like x-rays be necessary?
X-rays are usually taken, looking at the foot structure itself. Do we have a spur? Don't we have a spur? And that often will dictate the need for an over-the-counter support, because you have to support the arch one way or another, or do we need something by prescription?
How young are your patients when you see them? Are they really young kids that you're seeing nowadays?
Well, typically, kids that come in with heel pain are in a whole different category. I mean, kids 8 to 10 years old with all the sports, they get an irritation or an injury to the growth plate in the heel. So that's treated very differently, and that's self-limiting, but that's in a different realm altogether. But the average person that comes in with heel pain is probably anywhere from the late 20s up.
Does it matter if the pain is on the left side of the foot or the right side? Does that make a difference?
More so the inside or the bottom. That's typically more the key. I mean, there are other conditions that can cause severe heel and arch pain, such as tarsal tunnel syndrome, which is basically an entrapment of a nerve along the side of the foot going into the lower portion of the foot, and that's even more complicated. But typical heel pain is usually on the bottom or the side toward the bottom.
And typically, how is this these foot ailments treated?
First to diagnose, obviously, if it's truly just heel spur pain, very often you can control the arch structure, prevent breakdown, and then you actually eliminate the irritation. And although the spur would still be there, the pain is often gone. If it's a bursitis or it's the nerve pain on the inside of the heel, very often it requires a series of two or three injections and then support.
And when you say bursitis, maybe you could explain a little bit to our audience a little bit.
Sure. Many people have heard of bursitis, especially in the shoulder or the hip. But we frequently see it probably on a daily basis in the heel. And all a bursal sac is a fluid-filled sac that forms over a point of irritation. And then when you're off of it and it's irritated, it fills up with blood. So think of it almost as a little purse that gets filled up. You stand up. You can't walk the first 10 or 20 steps without hanging onto the walls. You know, you may be 30, but you feel like you're 90 until it goes away. And, you know, I've been there.
On average, how long is treatment? I know cases differ depending on the seriousness, but tell us a little bit about the average type of treatment, how long it takes, what's involved.
Yeah, typically someone coming in with a bursitis or the nerve pain on the side of the heel, you're going to be evaluated. You may or may not have an injection. You might have oral medication to start. And then depending on whether you need shots, it could take you a couple months to really get out of trouble. In advanced cases, heel pain, such as a heel spur pain that does not resolve, it becomes a surgical issue. Or there's another treatment, which is probably the newest that we have not spoken about in the past, is shockwave therapy. And there's several forms. We do a treatment in the office that's used very much on athletes in the pro arena, but we're using it on normal people. And for people that have resistant cases, it's basically done in the office, a series of three or four treatments spaced out over probably the course of a month. And that often will bring a reduction, but it takes about 3 months for pain to resolve.
And when you say shots that you referred to earlier, you're talking about cortisone shots. Cortisone shots. I know sometimes people get concerned about the use of cortisone. How do you respond to that?
It really is dependent on the dosage, where you're giving it, how often you're giving it. The type of cortisone that we typically use for these types of conditions, it's usually two or three shots. The max that we give in one spot, personally with what I'm using and the dose I'm using, would be a maximum of four, you know, within a six-month period of time.
You're listening to Healthline. Our guest today is Dr. Jeff Kahn, and Dr. Kahn is a podiatrist with Connecticut Foot Care Centers, and we're talking about heel pain, but also other related issues with foot, such as diabetes. Talk a little bit about that. People don't tend to think about that relationship that often.
Yeah, and in terms of diabetes, just some mind-boggling statistics that might really be interesting to most people. In Connecticut, there's approximately 350,000 diagnosed diabetics. In America, 30 million,
wow.
or just under 10%. So it's 1 in 11 Americans. 23 million of those are diagnosed, which means that there's over 7 million that have no idea they have diabetes. And the problem with diabetes is that it promotes injury to blood vessels and to nerves, which can affect you over time. So if your sugar is out of control long term, you build up a sludge in the blood vessels and your circulation becomes impaired. You don't heal properly. Nerve tissue becomes damaged. You start having what they call neuropathy or nerve pain, which is treatable up to a point, but not always completely controllable. So those are some serious things. It's estimated that 12 million or 1 in 4 adults over 65 have diabetes. That's astounding. Truly astounding. And the cost of healthcare is astronomical. And the complication rates for people that are diabetic are much higher than the average in the population. It's estimated right now about 65,000 people annually lose a limb. 65,000 people
That's
lose
incredible.
A leg due to diabetes every year. And 55% of those that have an amputation will die within 5 years.
Why is it in the foot that you see these complications? What is it about the foot in that area?
I think the biggest problem that really zooms in on the foot is that we're walking, the feet are getting beaten up. If we've lost sensation, we don't know we have a breakdown, or people assume it's going to go away. And on top of that, if you're running high sugars over 200, you know, normal is 90 to to 110, basically. But if you're running high sugars, you don't heal, you can't heal, and you don't fight infection. So things progress, the infection go down the bone, you know, and it's just a cascade of events. What's interesting, though, is that it's not just the foot. In addition to the foot, you know, it affects the blood vessels going to the eyes, the kidneys. There was some interesting stats, and one of which amazed me also is that annually over 50,000 Americans are being treated for kidney failure due to diabetes. So, I mean, it's something that needs to be diagnosed, needs to be recognized. It's not like leprosy. I mean, it's treatable.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to modify your diet. But in this age of us all being overweight, you know, sedentary lifestyles, constantly on your phones, on your iPads, people don't burn up the sugar, and it places more stress on our systems.
At what point do people with diabetes typically come to you? Do you see them mostly in the early stages where it is treatable? What's common, is there no commonality?
It runs the gamut all over. And certainly, we prefer diabetics to come in at least for screening. You know, you check the circulation, you check the nerve supply, you maintain that there's no breakdowns in the skin, that they don't have to apply hydrating agents or simple care, and that prevents tremendous complications down the road. So if you come in, you're doing fairly well, 6 months to a year, time to come back just to make sure everything's good. In our senior population, we see those patients probably every 2 or 3 months, you know, because that's when you've already had the damage. You've lost your circulation. You can't fight infection. You don't have the nerve supply. And those people that are in for regular podiatric care tend to do much better and have less complications overall. So the sooner the better.
What other problems do you see with the foot? You talked about the heel issues, diabetes. What else do you see as a common problem in your practice?
I mean, on a regular basis, we'll see people that come in with bunions and hammer toes. We'll see people coming in with ingrown nails on a daily basis. They'll often try to treat themselves, and when they get in trouble, they go see their physician. We'll put them on an antibiotic and soaks, which is great, but if the nails ain't grown, you can keep going on antibiotics. Until you do something to the nail that's cutting into the flesh, you're not going to get better. So those are daily things that we see all the time. People come in with warts and athlete's foot and fungal nails, and it runs the whole gamut. So it's a variety, which makes it kind of interesting.
And is it just the foot that you work with, or is it more up toward the ankle and the entire...
Right. Today's podiatrists, especially the more currently trained podiatrists, can do the surgeries involving muscles of the leg and do ankle repair, foot repair, treat sprains all the time, sprains and strains, injuries. So it's changed dramatically over the years. I was at a hospital meeting last night and just talking about some of the advances that certain doctors have gone with additional training. It's amazing.
And that was going to be my next question. What do you see as advances? What do you know of right now? What do you think is going to be happening in the next 5-10 years? We're going to put your soothsayer hat on.
I think you're going to see more and more better trained, more advanced trained docs coming out, doing more complicated cases. The majority of foot surgery is being done now by podiatry, nobody else. I mean, there are some orthopedics that do foot care, but most of the surgeries and cases are handled by podiatry. So that ranges anything from simple correction of a bunion deformity all the way up to ankle implants and ankle fusions, because ankles are becoming more prominent in terms of treatment. In the past, the implants were terrible. Now they're doing joint replacements that are coming along. I mean, still not like a knee or a hip, but they're better.
I've never heard of an ankle implant.
They're out there, and they're getting better. And there are some docs that are qualified to do it, even in the state.
Amazing. Really amazing. And maybe perhaps we'll have you back again in the future and talk about those particular subjects as well. But in the meantime, if people do have questions or want more information, how can they get a hold of you?
Sure. In the Middletown area, our office number is 860-346-5226. And in Rocky Hill, it's 860-563-1200.
Dr. Jeff Kahn, thank you again for being our guest on Healthline. Healthline is produced by the Community Health Education section of the Middletown Health Department, which is solely responsible for its content. Please join us again next month at this time, for another edition of Healthline.